Is that all you got to do? Thank you for coming out. We're really honored tonight to have Yanunu share a few words with us about her experiences. We don't know what she's going to share, but it would be a surprise. So maybe before we begin, Elizabeth could offer a prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful. We want to thank you. Thank you for this beautiful moment. For the queen coming out and sharing with us. Such a precious memory years ago when we look years ahead when we look back. This is going to be such a precious memory. Please work through Yanunu to share whatever we need to hear. And I pray for all of our hearts to be open to receive. And you want to touch us tonight, Heavenly Father. You are here. True Father is here. Jesus is here. Well, we thank you for this opportunity, and we give it up to you and praises, and all of the names of the Beth Center families gathered here are Jew.
All right, let's give it up. I met Father,
when I was conceived, right? Because we are, I'm second gen, right?
Hey!
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
If father is not there, then I will not be here, right? Because my father and mother will never, never will get married, right? So, it's like they're totally opposite character, and they're not type of people. They were not like that kind of love-dovey couple, so I cannot imagine without father, they will not really be together, and then I will not be here as a second. So, you know, I have to say that my life actually, you know, designed by father, right? When my father and mother was matched, my mother is a little bit slightly taller than my father. So in Asia, that was like a really no-no-no, right? Because my mom was like, she wants to at least, she wants to wear a heel, the high heel, right? So she insists, I don't know about this man, he's shorter than me. Yeah, we do that, we really do that. Anyway, so when father asked her, are you gonna get blessed with it? And then my mother said, she didn't answer. And the first father asked her, made them stand up, both of them stand up and then ask my father, ask my mother. He didn't ask my father. And then, are you gonna get blessed with him? And she said she didn't answer because she didn't like him. I guess my mother didn't like him. And the second time she didn't answer. And then third time, father was like, he was really angry. Like, she could not say yes. So she said, okay, father. And then she said, yes, father. And then father gave a word of blessing. If you get blessed with this kid, then you will have a general in your family. So that's how my father and mother got blessed. And then they had a first daughter, and the first daughter, a second daughter, and third daughter. And then finally they had a son. And then as you know, as you some of you know that my brother was. I don't know, I can't find the nice way to say mentally challenged, is that
special
another?
Need.
Yeah, special need. He was born with a brain damage, and then...
My son is
special. He couldn't walk until like 5 years old. So he was in the vegetable state about 5 years, and then I was the youngest, I was right above him, so I was always kind of take care of him. And at the same time going around the many places to find the cure for him around the whole country. And then in the midst of it, my father is pastor. So when I was born, my father was already pastor. And then by the time, I think that the church is almost like a 200 churches throughout whole Korea, so the church was really expanding around Korea. So I was like, I couldn't, you know, the reason I said I want to talk about, you know, once I really understand, I know I have a long way to go to study Bible. Once I get a little bit, have a knowledge about Bible, once I have a more relationship with Bible, I can understand Father much better. But at that time, I knew nothing about Bible. All I know was a Bible story. And then there was not a culture in our time to read the Bible seriously, take Bible seriously. Our Bible is like, you know, you don't have to know Bible, although the Bible, the divine principle quotes the divine principle quotes Bible how many times? Like 930 times, right? Yeah, 930 times. But they said you don't really have to know about Bible. It's like it's contradicting, but somehow it really seeps in the culture of Unification Church. And then we have somehow looked down on Bible. So you know, and then I thought what I only need to know is divine. So for me, it was like a very hard to, I couldn't really articulate at that time, but now when I look back, what I learned from divine principle was not really love of God or justice of God,
but it was more like a very, how to say, you cannot fail. That's the message I heard from Divine Principle. Yeah. If you fail, you're going to screw up the whole providence. So you better not fail. Either you don't fall, either you serve the, make the condition of, what is it, the substantial offering, or whether it's a
foundation
faithful,
of faith or foundation.
Yeah, foundation of faith, foundation of substance. Yeah, either that, you cannot screw up, you
correct.
Cannot fail. So that's the message that I heard, and then it's like it was heavy, and then the environment with my brother. And then I you know. From outside, I was perfectly good girl. From outside, I looked like a perfect A plus girl, right? I study hard. I help my mom so well, and then all this stuff. Inside, I was building the same. But so basically, I couldn't feel that hole. I couldn't see Father as a Messiah. So I did not have any foundation of Christianity, seeing God as a loving God. And then it was like the gap was getting like further and further, and I didn't know how to reach God. I didn't know how to pray. I didn't know what is the right way, but the resentment was really. And I think about look back, if that was the case. And then I got blessed. I was called one day to come to the Hanangdo, which is the Korean public father retreat. Guy there before the Capitol Palace, so I went there and then met Father for the first time. And I was like, I was 19, right? And I was 19, and then I was like, so surprised about Father is actually sitting there and he's moving. I was like, this is starstruck, right? And then it as if he's, I always saw him in the calendar, or I saw him like so far away in the big rally, so I can hardly, you know. I can hardly see. Is that Father, or is that the dot next to him is Father? Like I can't really tell, right? And then it was for the first time. It's about the distance where Jim is sitting, and he's moving, and I'm like, oh, he can move. He can talk. And then that was my first encounter with Father. And then we got blessed. Five children and graduating college. We spent 10 years and we're getting just to the family, the family culture and all that. But I have to say, you know what, all those time I never really feel serious to study Bible. So, you know, of course I love Father, of course I, you know, attend all the, you know, ceremonies, and of course I did all that. Because, you know, I was a good girl, you know. If you ask me, I was a good girl, and then, okay, I wanna do my best. But I did not know that the Father, I say it, but I did not know what it means. Him. Because him, I didn't know what it means to serve him as a Messiah. I actually did not know. Because I never was serious enough to really study Bible. So as so as we come to Pennsylvania, then I became really serious about studying Bible. Yeah, those two years that I that our King and I served the Father, the last 2 years of our Father serving, and then that time I really saw Father as he's a real deal. This was another bridge before I got into Bible. This was another bridge that I really helped me to find the Father. Because before then, you know, since I was young, I could see the big house, fancy car, and a lot of followers. I have to behave myself. That was pretty much, I have to raise my five children and then go to school. And then other things preoccupied. Other things preoccupied me, and then I couldn't really, you know, this is very important to me that I have to speak. I actually could not do that. And then I could not really seriously think about his Father Messiah and what does that mean to me. Even though I did a book church, a master, I more focused on what can I do to really, you know, help these members. But, you know, people can do things, they do it, but they sometimes can really miss the point. And that was my mistake. And it was very painful to actually serve as a pastor's wife at the ministry. So, everything, I feel like I have to do with my part. So it was a draining experience. And then the more I try to help brother and sister, the more draining I become. Mm-hmm. And then I could not really understand Father. And then, is it really real? Why is he doing all this crazy fundraising for Japan? Or why is he ignoring all these domestic violence that happened in Korean husband and Japanese wife, or Korean husband and Filipino wife? And there was so many questions. The more I do the pastor, serve as a pastor's wife, the more questions and the more doubt and more resentment really built in. And I did not know how to solve this. And then I served the Father really closely. That's the time I really can see who really Father is. Wow, the Father is, I have a very short experience, served the congregation, right? But like, I sometimes have such a nice face in front of people, but behind the scene, I become like so angry, or I become very nasty. And then I'm screaming at my children for like very little things, and I couldn't control my temper, and then all these things. And then but when I saw Father, what he does in public and what he does in private, it was exactly the same. That was the first thing that I was so surprised. How can a man become like a, it's exactly the same, and he's been serving this congregation for how long? It's like more than 70 years, right? And then he has this same heart for them. And then he would do the hundoke with them for 27 hours, 23 hours, and 30 minutes. We were there as Yosu at that time. So it was torturous. It was very torturous. Maybe I'm lack of faith, but you know, I saw many sisters who were like, they were literally just sleeping on the floor. Literally, they were sleeping on the floor. And then, that kind of experience. And Father, Father made me speak one time, and the Father said, and then I shared this, and one of the resentment that I really had was, if Father is really, good Father, how can he match my mother, father and mother to have such a brother? That was a big pain for me, actually. I mean, he has this, for a young mind, I couldn't really understand if he's a loving God, he would have given me only good things. And that's what I thought. That was my understanding. And then, of course, now I know better, right? We know that God promised not happiness. He actually promised a blessing, right? And then to get that blessing, we have to earn it, and then there's a hardship. Yeah, and then there's a process to actually get that blessing. But at that time, I couldn't really understand that. But anyway, and then I share this story, Father, you matched, and then, you promised we're going to have a general. And then my father came, and then he's like, he's a handicapped. And then Father said really profound. The Father said, you can be the general. Why your brother has to be general? So he said, and I was so surprised, actually, that moment. It was like, I think that moment was the first moment that I, actually I made a Father as a confined being. And Father has to be a certain way in order for me to accept And that was a breakthrough moment to really have a relationship with Father. And then I can see slowly Father as the, wow, the Father is real. The Father is being, he proclaimed, you know, I don't know what Messiah is, I don't know the depth of it, but I can see he's not lying. What he said, what he, when he says something, he's actually 100%. Yes. That's the thing I saw, observing him very closely. And then that was like a, that gave me like a foundation to really think about this, really wrestle with what I have been like constructed about, you know, loving God has to be this way, or justice God has to be this way. All this conception that I had, that it has to be this way in order for me to accept this, was totally really shattered. And then Father, and I really, you know, realized that Father, you know, I really always thought that, I'm sorry to say this, but I'm going to be honest, I thought Father was very confused. We went to Japan, how many times, like almost 30 times to visit Japan, and then we saw the ground, and it was very painful to see that our brothers and sisters doing the fundraising, and then they couldn't really pay for their children's tuition, and then they have to break the insurance money in the bank so that they can do the donation. It was just a pain one after another. One time I remember our second king, he felt so heavy about this donation providence in Japan. It was right before, it's 5 minutes before he go out and then he has to do the speech, right? And then he said, I can't go out, I can't face our brothers. We felt such a heavy spirit there. And then I really couldn't really understand Father as a loving Father. Am I jumping everywhere? I think I'm jumping everywhere.
No, you're doing
no.
Do you feel this spaghetti like a plate of woman? I hope you don't. Yeah, I think I'm sorry. Women have a spaghetti.
We know.
Yeah, I guess I'm like jumping all over the place.
We follow.
Yeah. Okay. But you're a woman. Yeah, so it was like when I saw Father as actually very cool Father, actually. As I don't think I kind of pinpointed, oh, Father is like this, and I think him this way. Actually, no, I didn't. Actually, it's just that there's like a heavy aura, and I just did not like it, and then there's a, I really don't like this. And I don't know, I want to face Father's face today. Like something like this. And then serving Father, I realized how loving Father he is. He's so loving. It's like incredible. He noticed the very little things, and then I share this. Story one time in the service. So if you didn't hear it, I wanna say it again. We went to Nigeria, and then there was a Father had to leave to the airport. He has to, you know, in order to get to the airport. That time he has to go to the Iceland first, and then he has to go to America. So the Iceland, he has to get to the Iceland before the Iceland airport closes, right? So he has to leave at a certain time. Otherwise, we have to extend the hotel reservation and all that. The money gets like the more cost. So we don't want to burden the cost for Nigerian church, and then one by one people were sent to tell Father, you better stop this speech so that we can go. And then one person went up, and then Father said, yeah, and then the other person, I think about five people went, and then it was a real really funny. So our king went up, and then Father just, you know, you dare tell me to leave here. I don't know when I'm gonna come back here. And then you're telling me to leave, and Father was very upset. And then Father just pushes us. And then I was like, dropped my jaw. and then I was just there. And then Father asked me to come up. And then he slapped me too. I was like,
what is this? What did I do with this? Oh, in public, what did I do?
I was in panic, right? And then I was like, a mom was really cry.
Oh, she was.
Okay. I was crying, but I at least had some street smart not to cry there to make the situation worse. Right? So I didn't cry, but I thought it was interesting to just to observe myself at that time. I was emotionally crushed, and then I didn't know how to react, but I just shut down myself and slept. Throughout the whole ride for 40 minutes from that hotel to the where the father speech was, and then to the airport. And then I just slept throughout the whole time because I did not want to talk to any leaders, and then they were like, are you okay? Everybody's like concerned me, and like, I don't want to talk to you now. Because if I talk to you, nothing good will come out of my mouth. So I was like, okay. And then I got to the airport, and then the father, my husband was doing fine. I was so surprised. I just got smacked by your father, and then you were okay about this. Getting mad at my husband too. Forgive me, Father. and he was doing fine, and there was a VIP who came to say bye to Father, and Father was totally fine, right? And then my husband was like a serving VIP, and then he was having nice talk with Father, and they were laughing, and like, what's going on? Am I the only one who has this? That was how I felt. And my emotional crush did not stop there, right? And then we had to ride the airplane, and then the whole airplane ride. I don't do games so much. I don't do games, but there's like a very simple game, like if you push it and then it pops, and then I did that game for 7 hours. Because it was a small plane. It was a small father's private plane, and I can't make ruckus about this, right? So I was like, I was doing it. I was just doing mind control. after the 7 hours, my arm could not move. So I I have a point to talk about this incident. Is that how to say? Because after this, I really realized the father as a loving father. Can you ever read that? It's like I felt like a hell, literally. He can't do this to me and all this, right? And then and my husband had such a good attitude. And so he was father. I can't believe, Father, you are still have like a 20 years old strength, and when you smack me like this, I feel full power of a wrath. That's such a good attitude. What a smile. I'm like, how can you do that? Can't you understand your wife? I was still in that dark mode. and then we went to the luggage claim area, and then father, we were picking up the luggage, and then his father is so interesting, I have to say this. And father felt a little better, and he got a better mood. And then one of our staff, to serve father, she said, it was a woman, and she was brave enough to say, oh, father, I think it was a little mean for you to, smacking the daughter-in-law. It's one thing that you smack your son, but I think it was a little mean to, it's kind of cruel to smack your daughter-in-law, Even the secular family doesn't do that. And she was like a brave enough to say that. And then I was like, did she say that? And I was like, I was there. And then father said this. And then he, after one statement like this, I was totally defiant. Father said, I never hit my daughter-in-law, I hit my daughter. That's what he said. And then it melted my heart. I don't know, I can't logically explain this, okay? I can't logically explain this, but wow, he embraced me. He viewed me as a daughter. Goodness, I felt so much closer to Father. So he doesn't actually see me as a separate entity, but he actually sees me as a daughter. Wow, I feel honored. you know, I cannot really explain it logically why I felt that way, but I really felt the Holy Spirit touch, just in the 7 hours anger of doing that again. And then, you know, and then after that, and Father, you know, a couple of times, I got, and then we went to Las Vegas, and I was like serving Father, and then all of a sudden, Father, like, as I serving food, Yona, you cannot hold any resentment about that. That is not okay. And he was making sure of that. And I felt like he's a little gentle concern that he has. How I thought, you know, I'm okay, and then I forgot all about it, but he was still,
very aware.
Yeah, he's aware that I can actually think about this and feel the resentment toward it. He was that gentle. And I was like, wow, that's amazing. And then a couple days later, he's asking me again. Yeah, you cannot feel any resentment towards about this, okay? There was a love of a father, okay? And it was making sure. I said, yes, with a loud voice. Do you understand this? And yeah, yes, Father. And then, you know, and then I see it. I really felt the Father's love there. How gently, how delicate he is when he deals with people. And then when he do something, he actually don't do it out of really hurt that person. But he actually does it out of concern. And then, you know, when I look back, I was a little bit, I was defiant. Yeah, I can admit now that I was like, why Father is holding everybody like this? And we have to go to Iceland. In my heart, I had that. So I admit that I was deserved to get smacked. So I can actually admit that now. So it's like a God's wrath and God's love, and then now I can see. Oh, it was like both of them. I experienced at the same time. That's how I felt. And then I see the really love of brothers and sisters by serving Father very closely. One time, you know, Father, we went out to the ocean, and then the commando is like a commando is like a. Yosu is the area that is part of the peninsula, Korean peninsula. But the commando is like you have to actually drive out to the ocean 2 hours, about 2 hours, and then it's from Yosu. So it's like a very remote island.
Take the boat.
Yeah, take a boat. And then they have like two times a day the big cruise.
Your
ferry moves back and forth, so it's like a very remote island. So father went to Komondo quite often, and then he built the ocean Chanjangrum there, as some of you might know. So we went there, and then father really loved to go there, and then he really loved to go out in the ocean, just like Jesus, right? When Jesus was when crowd gathered, and Jesus said, you know what, right now I need to have a time for prayer. So he leave the crowd behind, and he rode a boat, and then he went out to the ocean. And then that's what Father did. And then one time we went out, and if you know Father, once he go out to the ocean, and then the 7 hours is minimum. Right? Once he get out there, he just where did I hear this? Oh yeah, yeah. Where did I hear this? The sound of a stream is like the voice of God. Where I did? I think I read this in the Bible. Yeah. I think Father really heard the voice of God when he was out there in the ocean, and then it was like a meditation time. It was a praying time for him. So you know, so when especially when there's like a big ceremony or big proclamation, and it was he was out there to make the conditions to really get himself together spiritually. So you know, when he goes out there, it's like 7-8 hours, it's like a straight. And I never liked the boat ride, because I have seasick, and then I always like in the bottom of the boat, I'm like laying down. So I never really enjoy the boat ride. But father never had a seasick. It was like amazing. And then one day, Father went out, and then he was like rubbing his belly, and then he said, and then we parked our Father's boat, and then Father, it was only like 30 minutes, so the father said, out of this, let's go back. I never saw father doing that. I never saw father doing that. He was clearly, something was wrong, and then father wanted to go back. So we were like, in a hurt, and then we were scrambling around, and we put the this metal thing, anchor up, and then we quickly went back in. And then as soon as we get to the pier, dock, the harbor, there was like 30 or 40 our Japanese brother and sister with a big banner. And say, oh, father! And then they were like screaming at father. Father is like such a pain. And brother and sister, they came from Japan to see father. And then they got a message that father is coming back. And then with the big banner, they're so happy to see father. And then I can't remember which church they came from. If it's a Kumamoto church, and you know, and then the whole church welcomed father in Kumando and whatever. They all came out, and it was a big scene. And then, you know, I have to say, if I'm in pain, when I serve my congregation in Seoul, like a church, if I'm in pain, I'm like, I can't think about brothers. Okay, I'm in pain. I gotta deal with this first, right? I don't wanna see anybody. I'm gonna rest. That was my attitude, right? I was really because father is like 9 years old, and the brothers and sisters are talking. They're so happy to see father. They don't know father is sick, right? And the father said, you know, you guys came. Oh, please come to, please come to Heam Chungjung, Ocean Chungjung. And he invited everybody in, and then everybody came, and then father was so happy to see them, and then he gave them talk, and then he asked Hyunjin to sing, and then he did a celebratory thing for them, and he took a picture with them, and we all knew whoever close to father, and father was really, you know, sick, but he really kept a really good mood as much as possible to serve his brother and sister who came from far away to see him. He honored them. And it was like it was such a touching moment for me. Wow, this is actually not a father, and this is how she loves him. And he doesn't have to do it, you know, he could have said, oh, I'm sick, you know, let's not do this. And he could have asked whoever is representative to do that. The father is actually mindful enough to those brothers and sisters who are willing to come out and then about the Japanese, you know, I say, you know, as I know about Bible more, I can see Father as a Messiah, and I can understand Father more. The reason I keep on saying that is I can see what through Jesus' example, I can really see what Father did in his lifetime. Something I don't want to be too like a scholastic, so I'm not going to open the Bible, but I believe it's like a Mark 8, I believe. Mark 8. Mark 8, you know, Mark 14, when the woman came, and then she wants to use that nard oil for nard perfume for washing the feet of Jesus. And then everybody said, that's a worth of a 1 year wage. Why are you wasting her to Jesus' feet? And then Jesus said, we better serve with those money. We better serve poor with those. Or we can do something far better than that. And why are you wasting that? It was that expensive. It was a 1 year worth of a wage. That oil was that expensive. But Jesus said, I only come once. Poor is the only thing. As in the Mark 14, it says, and so that's where he was coming from. Actually, you know, there was a beautiful testimony that one sister, actually, her father and mother gave all to church. And then she got blessed with a Korean mother. And then she said she had a cancer too. She's about my age, she had a cancer. So she went through so much. And she had to used to get accustomed to Korean culture. And then she lost her brother through a car accident. And then she went through so many things. At such a young age. She's not even 40 yet. But you know what she said? I was so amazed. She said, she was one of the Japanese sisters who studied the Bible. I know nothing about the Bible course. And she, at the end of the course, she said, you know what? I had such a resentment for this donation plan. And she said, but after I studied Bible, she said, I realized actually me can participate in the Father's providence to serve Christ that way. And I was, our family was part of that providence. It was actually grace. Oh my goodness, she ministered. And I know, I cannot explain because all the, painful things out there. But I think that was, for her, for that particular sister, it was pretty important for her. And then I know that that realization can only come from this connection. It was not her, actually. To realize that he was the Holy Spirit in nobody can open somebody's mouth and say, you should say that or you should feel that. And I really found the Father. As I come here in the the wilderness, so to speak, I really felt that only thing that I can really rely on is Christ. And I really want to know about Bible. As our Second King really preach about, when you read about Bible, you have to really see Father in Jesus. That's what he said. And that was really helpful. And then I started to listen to the Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John first. I started to listen to it. I don't want to really open the, at that time I was, as soon as I opened the Bible, I feel like, I did not know anything about Bible, so I don't know so much about Bible, but at that time I was like a Zippo, right? I did not know, Mount Sinai was a real location, and then I did not know any of all those things. Sometimes I feel like I'm like a mix up, Jacob and Joseph and all these things, right? I was in bad shape, okay? Spirit really convicted me. You don't know Bible, and then you are telling me that you want to have a relationship with me, and that's not going to happen. And then that really convicted me. Because, just like our husband and wife relationship, when we meet for the first time, we don't know this person, right? And we don't know when this person does this. Does it mean he's angry or he's annoyed or he's thinking about something serious? We don't know. But as we live with this, our spouse, we just look at his eyes and we know what he's thinking, right? It's like something like that. The relationship builds over time. And then we can tell, oh, he's talking about this. Oh, she's talking about this. Oh, she's in this mood, so I better do this to make her feel better. Or, oh, she's in this, so I better, I know if I do this, she's gonna be very happy. And we know, right? And we know what triggers her, or what make her mad, or what make him mad, right? So we know all this detail that nobody knows, right? But it's like almost like a relationship with God, relationship with Christ is the same thing. If we don't know him, how can we love it, right? If we don't know him and what he wants from us, then how can we serve him, right? How can we actually know when he says something, when he shows signs, how can we know that's even a sign, right? So that was a conviction that I really got, and I really, that I know about. I mean, I'm still studying, and I know I'm going to be the, I will be the Word of God, my Bible will be my photo because we see the as our second king said, Bible was written by mom. That's what I'm saying. Just like a Christian sees the Old Testament is written by Jesus, right? So, you know, it will be the Word of Christ will be always my guide. As I have a more relationship, as I at least yearn to have want to know Bible more, and I can really see everything that all the things that happened with Father. Through the lens of Bible, and then what Christ means, and how much there's preparation to actually when he could receive inside, and I could never understand. We are so fortunate to live the same era with Christ, with the Messiah. I could like, okay, that sounds very nice, but it never came to the heart of me. It never came to me. So okay, that was a very nice statement. Oh yeah, I guess I am fortunate, but I have this that's like the back of it, and I have this huge resentment still there, and don't know how to solve it. And then it was like always battling inside of my heart. But as I really understand the really Bible, and even about my brother, right, I could not understand why God would really give our family something. You know, I have to really say, I know it's cliche to say, and like a dead lady is saying that because she's pastor's wife. I know you're saying that. You're thinking that. I understand that. But you know what? I don't know how to put it. I don't know what else I can put, what other word I can put, because Father really gave me extra to what should I say? John 9. It says in the book of John 9, it says there's a blind man. There's a blind man sitting there. And then it is right, John 9, okay? And then the disciple asks Jesus, why is that man blind? Does he have some kind of sin, or his family had a sin? Or why is that? Because that was that was the word of that person. He has basically hereditary, right? Yeah. Inherits their sin. That's why that person has sin. That's why that person is crippled, or that person is blind, or that person has such a child, right? Because from very young age, I love my mother and father, but they had a unsolved issue about my brother, and they are and they are not in good mood. They start accusing each other. It's from your ancestors' sin. That's why you our son like this. And it's from your ancestors. It was like a very painful thing to see for me. So it was like exactly the question that the disciple asked to Jesus. Is that like ancestors' sin? That's why exactly the guy is blind. But Jesus said he said this. Neither the man nor his parents sinned, but this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in. And it was such an answer. And I don't think if I read this a long time ago, might not be appreciating this scripture. But really, God knows when is the right time to give the right guidance and right word so that person can be really receive the Holy Spirit. You know, when we actually read the Bible and then that same quote, same word really convicts you, that is the time that Holy Spirit is coming upon you. That is the time. There's a many different ways that Holy Spirit can work for you through life, through situation, through people near you. But I really confess that when the scripture really comes inside of your heart, that is the time really Holy Spirit is working to you, working upon you. Because with your knowledge, with your limited understanding of God, you cannot actually get that through your heart. You are actually, many times I feel like my heart is so hardened, but He has a way to come into my heart. It was such a profound experience for me to get an answer. And then, you know, as a young person, another example that I really understood Father deeper and more. Another example was I could never understand Father, why Father says radical things to get more persecution. I want to go to my school, public school, quietly. I don't want to have all this, you know, back talk behind me, right? And I don't want to see Father in the front page of newspaper and controversial country, you know. I don't want to see any of those, right? And I could not understand why Father does what he does and making this claim that these four saints, great saints, are his disciples, and then he said, put that testimony in the Sega newspaper, right? And all those things. And then I don't know why Father has to wear a crown. And while I'm in the ceremony, I didn't know why I'm in the ceremony. Oh, Father, why can't we just live our life very quietly? And all this, right? I could not understand. That's exactly what I needed there. I could not understand, Father, why does he have to make it always controversial? Why does he have to make our brothers and sisters' life so difficult and all this? But I really realized that's what Jesus did too. Jesus always challenged the Pharisees. Yeah. Jesus challenged the Roman government. Yeah. And then he did not back down from the truth. That's what Jesus did, and then that was Father was doing. And then I really realized that our posture has to be the Father, disciple, and then the disciple, and then the apostles of Jesus, like a Paul, like a James, and that should be our posture. And then that was like such a big jump for me. Wow. And then the how Jesus was not actually accepting from people, and then the in John 8, it come out like a you are possessed by devil. Like the people, like the Pharisees, actually accusing Jesus. Yeah. You are possessed by demons. And then they were about to stone Jesus. See? So there was like and Father's the persecution that Father had, the six imprisonment that Father had to go through throughout all his life. This was for the And then this is why our brothers and sisters really took and get crucified. Some of them actually got martyred in some epic nations. This is what's all about. And then it really, I really could understand that. This is where this is coming from. This is why my father and mother is not crazy. They are not crazy. They are actually.
Can I say one thing about this point? Because as you know, I have a child with special needs. And a certain point when my son was around 10, I have done a reading with Philip Burley, he's a brother that channels spirit, and Yeon Jimin, your husband, son, brother, they really died, came to Philip Burley for me, told me that Ben was born so I can widen my heart and deepen my heart. So I believe that every parent with special needs go through a very special path for the purpose of expansion, to really become more, and like you say, just do really fill up. You really understand how God sees us. We are all handicapped from God's viewpoint, unable to be the way that we're supposed to be. Come out.
And I really love that it's not only to the limit to us, but it's actually really showing His glory mm-hmm. through this situation. And I think that's also very important, as Jesus said. And then I cannot imagine the pain he went through, because I saw my mother going through that process. But I'll save my comment about the spiritual medium at the end of the speech, maybe. Yeah, but the it's something that really I have this question for a long time, but the Bible really answered my question for that part, and then the understanding Father, understanding what was shared, and then I could see, I felt actually real pain that I could not serve Father the way I supposed to serve him. So, you know, that's one thing that I'm very, very repentful. As a young second, as a second gen, you know, you know what? Every second gen has to, at one point, think to choose whether I'm gonna follow this way or I'm not gonna do nothing to do with this. They actually have to make a choice. They actually think they can run away from this choice, but it's, I know, in the back of their mind, that choice is always lingering. It, you know, one sister put it very nice way. She said she struggled with faith, and then she went to Chungpyeong, and she did all sorts of things that she could do to really, in her own way, to find the Christ. But somehow, you know, she had this block, the spiritual block, that she could not really open up. Mm-hmm. And whenever she had that spirit, whenever she feels like she can open up to God a little bit, tiny bit, and then God is like tapping her shoulder. Are you ready to accept me now? And she's like, no, I'm not. Spiritually, she says that. And then the little, like a couple years later, God is like tapping her shoulder. Christ is tapping her shoulder again, the same spot. Same heart, that same, the aching heart that she had. He's making a point. You can never feel, in my term, you can never fill that hole with Christ, with anybody but Christ, anything but Christ, right? That's my term, I guess. But he's tapping her shoulder again, the Christ is tapping her shoulder. Are you ready?
Yeah.
And then she said, she must have to go through this over and over and over. So finally accept the Father as Christ. She went through the spiritual journey over. So, you know, I know some of you guys have a second generation. I don't know about my daughter, nor my son. I don't know. But that is like that the time thing is God is choosing my father. And then we don't know how he works. It's like how he worked me to make, to serve him. I'm not perfect, but at least I'm trying. I'm trying to reach out to him. That's like the first thing. And then he had a lot of patience to make me the way I am now. If he condemned me, oh, you don't know about this point. You are not ready for this point. Then I would have helped him better. So I'm very grateful to him. I don't want to speak too long. I don't want to make you guys to speak too long. But one thing that it really helped me as a second gen faith was this. You know, I almost felt like without me knowing, I was expecting some kind of miracle. Right? If he does this to me, or something like that, if he makes my brother into a normal person, then I'll go. Right. Or like if you make a miracle and then make my father and mother like becomes like lovey-dovey and they become like such a good husband and wife, then I'll believe. Or like we have this conditions, right? So one, until I see some kind of a sign in heaven or like a sign in the nature, then I believe God, right? So I have this wrong notion of understanding God. And one pastor really put this thing very beautifully. He said he came. One person came to the service, and it was a revival service, and then he came up, and then the pastor was praying to him. And then he said, and at the end of the prayer, Pastor, I have a question. And he said, I flew 3 hours to participate in this. I'm not a believer in Christ, but I hours to participate in this service so that I will see miracle. Well, how come you prayed in my head and how come I don't see any miracle? And then the pastor said, you know what? The fact that you drew 3 hours to come to this service is a miracle. And then you are like this. You are like this. You are focused so much in the finger that is pointing to the God, you can see the amazing miracle that God always has done. And then the miracle is like the tip of the finger. You are focusing so much. So as a second gen, wow, that was what I was doing. And then when I actually see, as I have an interaction with words and my life is changing, and then the word is comforting me. And when people said, hey, I used to be very offended and I feel very insecure about it. But as I have a more relationship with the words and with Christ, and I don't feel offended that easy. And I don't feel like insecure about these things, the little minor things. But, and I have a real peace. When I have I really have a joy to know brother and sister who has the same thing. And that these are not the thing that I did, but it's a work of Holy Spirit. So when I see that, wow, the little change, it's actually beautiful. And then that really helped me to view a miracle differently. The beginning of my faith life. At second gen, that was really helpful. And then, our second gen, he used to say about divine principle, like this. Our second gen, they don't know they're sitting on time. That's why they're always sitting on time. So they don't know that is diamond. Because for other people who know the value of diamond, that is the diamond they're sitting on. But as a second gen, we're always, sitting on diamond. So when we see divine principle, of course the ball of man is the ball of man, right? It was not the eating the apple, of course. But for some people, that is like the amazing. This is a word, wow, this is what Christ is. That's how they actually perceive it. That's why all the spiritual is here, right? So, I can go on and on. But I really wanna, whatever that we go through, I know I cannot explain with this one, but we have a really heart of gratitude if we go through whatever condition, situation we go through. If we go through that with a heart of gratitude, and then he really works you and I. Our Father works in one way and another. We might think that was a curse, just like me. I used to think my brother was such a curse in our family. But now it makes me serve our brother and sister in a deeper way. I can relate to you right away, right? And yes, you can relate to me right away, right?
I know.
How can I relate to you? Because of this experience, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Father, at that moment I might not know the full plan of God, and He might not let me know His full plan, otherwise I might run away from it, like a thousand miles away, like Jonah, right? So He has a great plan. He doesn't want to tell me. So He doesn't want to tell you the full plan that He has to you, right? So as long as we have if you trust His word, and then if you have a faith, and not lean on our understanding, but His understanding, His knowledge, His wisdom, so that's how I want to end my sharing. I have a question. And before I accept the question, I just want to have a comment about the spiritual medium. Our second king has a very, very...
This was 20 years ago, by the way.
So, I'm sure you guys know, but just in case if you guys, any brothers and sisters who don't know about spiritual medium, how our second king knew about spiritual medium, we know that our Christ can work directly through us, right? And He can have a direct personal relationship, right? We don't have to go through a spiritual medium to tell us. Our second king puts this way: I don't need any spiritual medium tell me what my father thinks.
Absolutely.
Or what my brother thinks. Okay,
yeah.
I know him better than that person. Okay,
yeah.
So that's how I put it. So I just want to make it clear for brother and sister who have any concern, please talk to us.
Actually, with that, understanding, I believe that I'm not the only one that experienced that through Father Reverend Moon, actually, talked to the Ungent. And if that is so, that Reverend Moon, the Second Coming and Jesus are one, so through Yonjini is Jesus and his Father. They really talk through him. That's the way I perceive it.
Yeah, but I want to stick to the, what I think I can say. Because it can be, you know, it's like if we saw the precedent, right, with the Umo. So, you know, in the beginning they begin with a very good heart, but it can be corrupted because they are not perfect.
No, are you saying that through Father is talking to your husband or not?
You know, the, when Holy Spirit is talking to us, and they give us prompting, and they give us teaching and wisdom, there's like a, you can say that it's like, is it directly, is Christ directly talking to us, or it's like, what is it, right? This is like the same question, right? When Father is talking to give, I was thinking the, guidance and the direction, is it like a directly talking to you?
Yeah.
You know, it can be like that, or it can be, you know, into some different form, or he, you know, or like a, he has a previous experience with Father, close enough, so he will know what Father wants, and what Father would make the decision at that moment, and things like that. I think
but
it's
is it in the right contact, right?
Yeah, I don't think it's like the way that spiritual medium coming to your...
No, I'm not talking about the medium. I'm talking that Yonjini, the spirit of the Father, is really guiding directly, maybe not on the same way, but is really guiding your husband.
Yeah, of course. Yeah,
that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, we all
and with that, Jesus is also, as a dispensational evolvement, if I may say, right?
Yeah, we
believe
that, right?
That's
why you guys are all here.
What is the point of being here?
Yeah, no, but it was not clear that Jesus that through Father is talking through him. For me, it was only through Father before. But now, because of the Bible and because of everything, they really want.
I really thought it was a maybe revelation, at least for you. The Bible was written by Father. So that was really, you know, something that I never really thought about. Yeah. So So if you want to, you know, when you go back and then, okay, I you know, that the lady tonight who spoke at Blue Storm Farm, she said, oh, we gotta read the Bible, so where should I begin? And you guys might, you know, wondering. No, I would suggest you to read the Book of John first. And then if you have a hard time reading the Bible, then you can just listen. Then you can just start from there. Some people suggest me to read Proverbs. You know, I personally like the Book of John first. And you can see a Father as the Jesus. See Jesus through the lens of Father, it's like a force, and then it really helps me to understand Father. Like there was a big crowd, and then Jesus was totally ignored, so Jesus had to just walk out quietly. Those scenes really, you know, really touched me, because Jesus went through the exact same course that the Father did. And then that, wow, now I understand the persecution and all of these that Father had to go. This is such a, for me at least, I don't know how, you know, the Holy Spirit will guide you, but for me, the Book of John was the beginning of opening my heart to really want to have this conviction. I'm going to read my Bible like this.
Father has lived such an extreme life, and it seems like the second king is following in his footsteps, in the sense that Father really pushed Mother, you know, in terms of ocean providence and different things, and now it seems that the second king is really kind of pushing you in this...
Can you see the bruise?
So I'm just wondering, what's your experience trying to keep pace and understand? Do you see the parallel there when you
look at your life?
Well, it's just so funny. You know, as I prepared the tonight's sharing, and I was driving up to the Bluestone Farm, and did that short distance, I was thinking about, you know, yeah, that's right, Father, you know, actually, you need to become a general, and all that. Oh my gosh, I'm doing the general training! And I was like, I don't know how that came in my head, but in order to become a general, you gotta go through this military training. It was funny that you asked me. You know, I think, you know, that I don't know, maybe I'm jumping the, maybe like a stretching your extra, but I think a lot of brothers and sisters can soften that I might become an example, like a mother, right? A mother, or like now she might be like a follower, you know, all boosted up and then doing a face and like whatever. Like, but you know, what if she gets like a resentful and then do the repeat the scene of her mother and then you actually concerned about her. So you know, I actually get this question a lot. So you know, I it's quite cute. One of the high schooler when I went to some I think a winter camp I went there and then one of the high schooler actually asked me was a high schooler boy. Yeah, he asked me this question. I thought he was quite honest that he was willing to ask me about it. I was actually I didn't feel any bad about it actually. Yeah. And then I answered this way, I answered, you know, first of all, our second team will remind me not to become like that. And then second of all, our brothers and sisters will remind me. Plenty of them. Plenty of you guys will remind me. And then I think in order you guys to for you guys to remind me if I go off track, so to speak. And I always have to be among you, right? And that's why I love HSC class. Because I'm there, I talk with our brothers and sisters, and then, you know, they can come up to me and then they can tell me, you know, straight. And it's very small, and then they can, you know. So it's, you know, to me, that's another trick, you know, brothers and sisters, you will have, you know. And then the third one is, I actually don't think it's only cross that I have to carry. Because, you know, every single lady here, or every single gentleman here, we all have that cross, right? It's not only me who might betray Father, so to speak, right? Who might, you know, once I was faithfully serving Judah Iscariot, and then when the temptation came, he became the betrayer of Judah Iscariot. I'm capable. But you guys are all capable to do that. So it's not only my cross, but it's like that every single person who's here, they actually have the same cross. I might complain, oh, my cross is the heaviest, right? But who says my cross is the heaviest? Who says that? And I actually, you know, I can humbly say that some of our brothers and sisters, we all have that capability, so it's not only me. You know, it's interesting. You know, I have to say that going back to the original question, am I speaking the correct English? Sometimes I'm like, my English is like jumbled up, and I don't know whether I'm speaking correct English or not. But if I say more like a close answer to your question, well, I'm not a very like a physical person. My major is studio art, okay? I love to paint, and that's what I do, right? And then the physical stuff was very tough for me. Very tough, and it's still so tough.
You tough it up.
It's still tough, but one thing I know, you know, I think this is why, you know, now I live with my second game for 20 years, it's like 20 years. So I know him enough that he will not make me do things that he's not doing. So if he makes me do this, I know because I need a trip, so why he makes me do this? Okay. But I know, you know what, the light is so bright, That's why I'm looking at this side.
It's not that I don't like you guys. Just make sure, okay? So don't cry, okay? No, don't cry. That's why I'm looking for the people.
Yes, you know, I know my husband that he will not make me do things that he will be harmful, or he make me do things that to take advantage of. Something like, look, you know, she's doing it and you guys can do it. It's not like, how to say, look how, you know, a good husband I am to make her listen this well. Or it's not like that kind of way. I know him enough that he will not have that motive. Sure, you know, he's proud of me when I smash some, like, first jiu-jitsu comer, and I'm sure he will be very proud of me. But he actually, I know him enough. You know, I cannot explain any other way. Because I've known him for 20 years very closely, so I have that much trust. Even though it's not always pleasant. I complain. That's another thing. Who said I'm always like a good and a 100%? Who said that? Okay, I'm bitching and complaining many times. Okay, I admit it.
Can you teach a little bit about Duncan's attempting to father?
I feel like I don't want to like drag it on and on, but so that's why I didn't really talk about our engagement bond. You know what? When I see father and I'll say because I'm gonna say father. Father and Kim is just a little bit like, awkward. So I'll say father and Kim. There might be a profound way, I don't know, but this is how I see it. And I see something he made, you know, I think this is what something gave my this is what I am about to see. The experience of father and son relationship. The father and son relationship, Tongjinim make father experience what it's like fatherhood. Real relationship between
father and son.
There's no string attached. It's not like, oh, if I serve, if I be good to you, then he will give me position. Or if I be good to you, he's going to give me house. Or anything like that. He's going to give me money. Or anything like that. But it's just a pure joy being together.
Yes.
That is the experience that he gave me, and that's the experience he gave me.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, he does some calligraphy. You know, his calligraphy was terrible at the beginning. I'm like, are you serious to hand them in the house? It was that bad, okay? Now I have no complaint. But, you know, in the beginning it was really bad. And you know, he would go to father and, oh, father, how can you write this? And father, you know, write it in the newspaper. And then he practiced, and then next time, you know, he write it in a beautifully, and then he show father, oh, father, I improved so much, right? And the father, oh, you improved so much, I'm so happy. And that kind of very little thing. Something like they watch, you know, the MMA together, this mixed martial arts, this like a ground pummel, ground the pound, right? That scene together, and they're so happy, and then he would call like the security guard, and then, oh, father, this is, I think they did like this, and then this is like, and the father's like, oh, that is so interesting, do it again. Something like that. It's like a very simple, but very like a personal, but there's no strong attachment. You know, when we serve the father, we basically, our second king, you know, he gave up everything. He was serving as a mega church pastor, right? Yeah. He, you know, he left that all behind. Okay, I don't care about church. And then he was having a lot of interviews, he was getting a lot of attention from media and all that. And he left that all behind.
Yeah.
And then he might feel like insecure. Oh, you know, what if I'm, when I'm not here, you know, if my position is not solidified, what should, what I'm going to do, right? He could have think like that. And he, he did not even, like, care about children. And then he, we have to leave them behind. It's almost like a 8 month out of, like, 8 month out of 12 months a year, we were the father. Like, only 4 months we were the kids. And then many times we were in Korea, we were in Kongdo, or we were like Yeosu, and they're in Seoul. That's like 5 hours or 7 hours, you know, away. So, you know, he left everything behind, and then we didn't know when father will ascend, right? We didn't choose the day. So, you know, if it becomes 20 years of service, that was his death. It was like a 5 years also. It was 20 years, I was sleeping. And I don't have any attachment to what I was doing. So, how great leader I am, or how whatever, you know. He gave all that up. He gave that up. He did not think about it. He focused on serving father. And I think that was the, you know, thing that father, and he gave father the experience. What it's like, mommy's. Because father always has to be to his son. And then the, oh, is he going to be the success? Oh, is this person going to be success? And there's always like a policy around that certain good child, and then, you know, they make a group, and then, you know, they have an agenda, or, oh, father, you know, you do the so and so and so, but this person's bad, and please remove this person from this position. And all these strings were attached when they meet together, right? But when in our second something, third father, there was no such a string of attached. And I think the father really helped me about it. He would bring the dough in, and then give the snack, and then a little bit. Make the gyeongbae, and then all this simple thing. And but he would make her. He would train. Hyungjin would train Dong-il to make father happy. He would make buy all these birds or all this lizard, and to show father. My father, look at this lizard. The blue tongue skin. He can eat them. Isn't that amazing? And they were like a watch. And those kind of things. Those kind of very little things. Father, feel, you know, wow. Father is really wonderful. I think that's, of course, he would serve, our second, he would serve him, not only as a father, but also as a son. I think that was, that's another thing. Because there's many things that if you only truly see things from a son's perspective, then you can feel very bad. Can be very angry or whatever, right? And he, also, I have to say, he's a really amazing man. Yeah, I'm the biggest fan of mine. But you know, he's amazing because he's extremely masculine, and at the same time, he's extremely feminine. It's like he knows style better than me. Like this hot pink and then this gray pants goes perfectly well. Something like this. And then he can do the ground pound, like MMA. It's like, how can you juggle these two worlds like so perfectly? Like, and then he can juggle. Why has it become like a show and tell about my husband? But he can also can really understand the Western word and the Asian word, and he can really understand these two words. He can go in and out. So that, you know, father is like that. When I think about father was like that. I was sharing this with one of the Korean sister that I met today. And father is like, father would practice wrestling to win this guy for 6 months, right? And he lost it. He practiced 6 months to beat this guy in wrestling, right? And he is a very masculine, and he loves MMA, and he watches all that. And he is very masculine. He loves his martial arts, and he will not get that way. At the same time, father, in his autobiography, he would make a hat for his sister. He would make a hat for his sister. So you know, he has such a gentle heart like that. So it's like an arm, like a mom makes it. Mm-hmm. And that's how I do it. Many things, like a Nigeria time. I, you know, I was really amazed by it. This is why I really, not only loving, but I really respected, because two times I can share this in the service, but for anybody who did not hear about this, it was a Nigeria hotel, and the father was a bedroom, and then there was a little, like a there was a little living room that is attached to father, where father can rest. So, you know, it was like a, usually the father is very comfortable, like 5 o'clock. Usually before the helicopter sitting, father would get up like 1 hour early, and then, oops. The white pants, right? White pants. That is, it's like a nowhere white pants. He always do. And then he like runs for 40 minutes, and he does stretch, and he wake up at about 4 o'clock. He does his sleep. The father is very punctual. He never lays on the bed on top of him. But that time, father was late. It was 5 o'clock. Everybody waited. I was waiting outside. And there was 6 o'clock, father's not coming out. What the fuck is going on? Everybody was like wondering what's going on. And later on, we found out that that time, the father opened vision somehow. You know, it was right before the table. He saw some kind of vision. We don't know what he saw, but father was like telling the attendant staff, you know, staff, and the grandmother was there. And then the the moment the company went in, like the staff and her mother was like shaking, and they didn't know, they were like, they didn't know what to do. Father was screaming at them, and then move this red boy, and move this. And then he was like, somehow on the people, he was like doing this as if he's like moving the universe. And then the people, the attendants, and her mother didn't know what to do. Like, why is he so all of a sudden angry, and what's going on? They couldn't like figure it out with their, you know, normal understanding. And then the, you know, the second thing stepped in, and then he said, father, do you want this to move? And then, no, move that one. And then there was like a little like a bucket of urine that father cannot like move, was not so mobile that time, so he has like a little bucket of where it's like a portable bathroom, so to speak, okay, nicely put. And then it was, that one was there, but father said, knock that down. And then I said, why is he gonna knock it down? He knock it out, and then of course he picked it up. And then, but you know, father was like older, he could do certain things. And then the our second he followed, he was like a wicked.
Yeah.
He was total object. He was willing to, you know, he can't see what father sees, but he was willing to be 100% there for father.
Yeah.
He was not having like this second thought, using like what's going on, just like everybody else. And then I it's kind of sad that, you know, that night, grandmother called all the leaders in. And then one by one, and then, you know, that was the time that mother was telling everybody that father is sick. And she called one leader at a time, and then father is not in the right mind to see what happened this morning, and she would explain. The reason we know about this is actually one of the leaders came to our room and then told us, this is what mother is saying. She is saying father is sick, so what should we do? Still I remember, and then it was 8 o'clock, and then he came in, and then this is what I said. He said, you know what, we even believe this Indian tribe, to like this fortune telling shaking the rice and shaking the leaf, shaking the leaf, and then, whoa, like, and they said, oh, there must be something, and like this, and then, why can't you even believe that what the sun is?
Right.
That's what I was like. I would never think when there was, that kind of a non-faith to Father, give a total, obedience to Father. And then another incident was Hawaii. It's actually three. Yeah, in Hawaii. I'll say that Las Vegas was first. In Las Vegas, people were so concerned. Their father is, going to the casino, and then I don't know what to do, and then, I think we should don't let him go, and then it's like confidential and all that. And then, the whole theater school actually, had this secret meeting with the, I was like, okay, we have secret meeting. And we went to the upper room, and then, they said, we should do this, and then, we should stop him, and then we should stop him. Las Vegas providence and all that, right? And then the that time, I was thinking, Jesus went around with the prostitute and textbook. And that's what our fathers do. And why can't you understand this? That's what it said to me. Wow. And then the third one that I remember is I'm just speaking very, a short term. That is when it was in Hawaii. And this is all happened while we are thanking Father, right? And then when he was in Hawaii, Father was, Father was sitting in the giving talk. And then, grandmother was in the queen garden. There was a king garden and a queen garden. And she was in the queen garden, and Father is in the king garden, doing the window care here. And the Father, all of a sudden, he's stopped pulling his pants down. And then, pulling his hands down, and then he put the elderly man, the elderly people, they wear a diaper, right? And the father took out his diaper.
Oh my God.
And then people freaked out, imagine in the middle of Hundoke, and then the everybody was like, all the security, they circled around him, and they put him to put the pants up, and then, that moment, our king went out, and without any, embarrassment, and he put the mic up, and then, don't worry, this is what happened, and this was Adam and Eve did, and then you don't have to feel embarrassed, this is Hawaii, and the father is showing that he has that much closeness. So don't worry about it. This is you guys don't have to worry about it. And then we ran off. And it was my mother was very embarrassed about it. And then without any judgment, without any embarrassment.
That's love.
This is a Garden of Eden. That's how it's said. And then that's I almost thought that is the test that Noah had to do to his servants. And it's of course you cannot understand with human eyes and human understanding. But Bible is full of that kind of story. How can we explain Noah? How can we explain Noah, your son's getting that much curse? From the covering the reproductive organ of his father, right? All of these things that we cannot explain. But God demands faith in that situation. And if we really believe Father is a Messiah, that is something that we can see, we should see with the lens of Christ. So that was he was doing. And that's that tube lamp that he made Father experience the real fatherhood without any screen attached. And that was always Father's experience with all his children. And then the, but at the same time, he will honor father as a son. This two extreme, seemingly like extreme, but he really blended, and then he would serve the father, our Christ to be. So I think that's like my testimony about the way this is going.
The beauty of your vulnerability.
Vulnerability?
Yes, you've been very vulnerable. I think there is so much beauty and courage and spirit in that. And I honor that. Thank you.
You know, that's also, that courage came from the Bible too. I'm not joking. You know, there's a beautiful quote. This is like one of my favorite quotes in 2 Corinthians. You know, the Paul is talking about, I'm sorry, am I sound
no,
preachy?
No, you're good.
I'm sorry, if I'm too sounds too preachy, I'm sorry.
Preach it, sister.
You know, this is the time that the Paul is asking God, wow, God, you know, this stone in my flesh is hurting so much. But remove it for me. And then the Paul asked God three times, he said, three times. But God said, I left that stone in your flesh on purpose. And then he says this. This is one of my, it's just like my Bible quote that I really love. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me, that's in Paul, right? In the 2 Corinthians 12. But he said to me, because God said to him, to Paul, My grace is sufficient for you, for my power made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness. He said he will gladly boast about his weakness, because that's like the reminder how weak I am and how much I need Christ. Mm-hmm. And then he continues. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. He said, that's why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness. He said he delights in weakness. And then the inserts, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. He can delight in weakness. For when I'm weak, then I'm strong. It's like such a beautiful word. You know, I was such a self-conscious person. Why is this person like a frowning? Is this person not liking what I said? Or like all these like little things, that paranoia. I was such a person. And I was like, I have to have always perfect massage. And like, that's why I was so miserable. I was so miserable because I always have the perfect yonanim, right? And then, as I kind of interaction with the word of God, my weakness is, of course I'm weak. Of course I'm not perfect. Why do you struggle? Of course you're not, but that's why you need Christ. You know, you might not use it as a second gen, I'm so grateful, I might not at all use it. But you have so many other sins. You have hereditary sin. You have, I know Korean, I don't know in English, collective sin, and what else?
Personal
sin. I have all those sins. See, so, of course I'm not perfect. No, of course I'm weak. But, when I actually accept Christ, that His power can work through my weakness, then, I realize, I need Christ. And that's like such a beautiful realization. When I'm weak, I'm most strong. Wow, Holy Spirit is working. So that's why I think without worrying and without thinking, I said this, and what would they think? I said I was really not faithful, what are they gonna think? And all this, right? I don't have to worry about those. And I can sleep in peace. I can sleep in peace.
Don't worry. I have one.
what?
Okay. We went this way, so should we went this way? Yeah, after this. Yeah.
Do you think that a mother with cheap cheddar can show you? So, you know, I drink his father. Do you feel it happening?
I'm not in, you know, hot mother's head, right? Who knows? But, you know, when I see mother, when we hear what she tells to people, when we crash. And one person said, you know, when he went to mother, she said, I was always smart. My teacher said, told me I was always smart. That's what she said. I said, why is she saying this? Because she had always this complex that she only graduated high school. She couldn't really, you know, she couldn't really get the proper education. She always had this back in her mind. And then all the, you know, the all the other ladies around her were like, women.
Far
better job than before. Mm-hmm. And she was like, so sure. You don't know what my mother, her mother, Mrs. Holmes, yeah. who's channeling through the mall.
Yeah.
You don't know what they can do. You guys cannot do what they can do. So it was like a perfect, she was period. It was like, you don't know what they can do, you cannot. You guys are young, immature, don't know what you guys are talking about, and this is, she can do far better than they do. So it's like, when I hear that, that's like, I can hear that some competitive thing that her legacy, her mother, can do far better than her son. I can see there is a
So Demoline was working with the mother.
That's what all the this Huma Chokka thing is all about, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. She sees Huma as her mother.
Yeah.
In a very strange relationship. Mm-hmm. And if you know that Huma's physical son, I hope you guys find Huma's physical son, he's grown up and he's adult. He is adopted. Spiritually, I think it's spiritually adopted. After certain age, you can adopt legally. So this person is adopted to the Mrs. Hong, who is a mother's Han mother's mother. You guys follow?
Hyunam Kim's son.
Hyunam Kim's physical son.
Okay.
He is claimed, and they got permission from father and her mother. That to be adopted to Mrs. Hong, who is the mother's mother. So basically, Huma's physical son and Han mother is like a brother.
Right.
They actually built that relationship. And then that very son was the basic CEO. He was a real CEO behind the scene who ruled the whole team. There's a lot of problems.
But it's true that the demon husband took a lot of money and ran away with the love?
I don't know. This is my honest answer. I don't know. There's many rumors about it, and then the one thing that we know is their relationship. So, I don't know. That's my honest answer. I will not claim the information that I do.
We always talk about the Bible and focus on the Bible's word. Now recently I started to study a lot about fathers, because especially about the seed and all these things, and what father talks about bone and arrow, and I was really curious about all this, of the true love God and fathers, this relationship has in life. And I went to all fathers, like all the way, whatever I could find, I just printed them out there and went to PDF. But because I always see the Bible, I mean, I can go only that far in the Bible for this topic, but I took two father's teachers, I mean, over and over, so I just talking about the Bible. Now I feel Father is guiding me through his word, because for that special question. But is there anything?
That's wonderful. That is wonderful. That's what I said. You know, if the word of Father has a Christ really has to speak to you,
yes.
And then that is the,
yes.
You know, that faith that, you know, you really want to pull your heart in. That's wonderful.
Yes.
That's wonderful. Because so what I'm saying is, for me, I had no foundation of understanding Father, in the depth. Why, what is meaning to preparation of 6,000 years to have a Christ? What is that? I do not know what that means. I say it, I might pretend I know, but for me, without really understanding the Bible, I do not know what that means. So that's all I'm sharing. That's wonderful.
We can be your
who's,
mother.
Who's against about that?
It's always so overemphasized,
yeah.
And I'm feeling it now. You know, do I miss something?
No,
but
no, not at all. You know, we are emphasizing that we can actually make a lot of mistakes to see Father as a family land. We can really see Father as this interreligious land.
Oh,
all the religions are fine, but
yes.
Islam is fine, and all this. So when we emphasize Bible, you really have to see Father, understand Father from the foundation of the Christian. And yeah, then you can fully understand Father. Mm-hmm. That's what I believe also. Then you can have actually keep the relationship with Father. Mm-hmm. So that's where we are going.
Oh.
And then this is another thing that I just taught myself. Mother, Johan's mother, she said she never read the Bible. And she never got divine principle lecture.
Oh, wow.
This is what she said. And then, but she knew everything. That's what she said. And at one point, I thought I know Bible. At one point, I thought I know Bible. But as I actually got into it and have a given receive relationship in a very small way, I realized I know nothing about the Bible. Okay, that's like my confession, that title of
your vulnerability.
Yeah, so it's like how arrogant I was to say that I know the Bible, just knowing the couple name of it, I never knew that the Bible, the Genesis ends with Joseph. I did not know. It's like a whole divine principle is all about restoration process, and then the whole Genesis like elaborated. So I never really thought about Genesis ends with Joseph. I never knew. See how much I did not know about Bible, but I'm like so arrogantly to say that I know everything about Bible. So it's like a tradition. The reason I say this is if her mother would have a given view with the Word of God, that if she had that foundation, solid foundation, she could see everything through the lens of this is a posture of the leader. This is how the way, this is what they led, it's what they died for. Mm-hmm. And all these things the Holy Spirit could guide her, but she never finished the Bible. She never knew the necessity of really grounding her faith in the Bible. Mm-hmm. She was the only thing.
Thank you.
I think you guys have to go.
Father, thank you so much, Father. Father, the reason we are standing here is from all your grace and mercy, Father. Father, as we go forward, Father, let us. It is not. We really hope and pray that it is not about us, Father, but it is become really to glorify you, Father. Father, we truly believe that once we were faithful, next day we can have a huge potential to become like Judah, Father. So Father, guide us our way with your understanding and wisdom, Father. We ask for we need your guidance and wisdom, Father, so that we will not falter, but we can really walk the way that you plan us to walk, Father. As we go forward, the Father and the second thing, the successor that you chose for us to lead, Father. We humbly follow him as a in the position of disciple, Father. Father, let us have a wisdom. Let us have your wisdom, Father. Let us have your understanding, not our understanding, Father. And we truly believe that if we lean on you, if we trust you, if we really open our heart and open our spirit eyes and to see where you're leading us to, Father. If we become really, really very hard to open our hearts, then Father, we know that you will give us guidance to make our way straight, Father. Thank you so much. for our brothers and sisters. Father, your life was not. Look at all these brothers and sisters, please, Father. They are willing to walk in the fire for you, Father. You are the Messiah. You are the King of Kings. You are the wonderful counselor. You are the Lamb, Father, who gave us everything, Father, the truth of life. And you gave us true image, Father. We are just eternally grateful, Father. We love you. We glorify you. Let our life become to show your glory, Father. So thank you so much once again. And we pray all these things. And this is your blessed name, blessed family name, number one, number one. And then all our brothers and sisters, blessed family name, we pray in the amazing Christ name. Amen.
Don't believe.